Participate in that a big outreach to the church. If you have questions about it, Ashley will be happy to help you and tell you where you need to be or what needs to be happening, what roles are taken. So we're getting geared up for that. Thanksgiving service is coming up, so be in prayer for that. Be ready when that is announced. I don't know what is that.
Next Sunday will be our Thanksgiving here at the church. Right after service, we'll have our lunch across the way. We are needing 3 turkeys and 3 hams, so if anybody can donate those, you need to see Jeanette today before you leave, so that way we can make sure that we have all of that underway. And besides that, everybody needs to bring sides, vegetables, salads, bread, and it's all potluck. So this is next Sunday, and y'all, we got some good cooks here at this church, don't we? So come hungry. And invite some of your family to come. It'll be our traditional Thanksgiving service next Sunday. So,
if you have not turned in your basket for the fish brine auction or you have something to donate, please let me know. We're going to get that posted pretty quickly.
All right. Cam, go ahead.
Work day next Sunday, next Saturday for live activity. We need all hands on deck.
All right.
8:30.
All right, anything else? Anything I'm missing? Probably is. All right.
Tell them about the community church service that we're going to provide some details about.
Yes, there is a community Thanksgiving service that we will provide more details about when we have those. We talked about that, and I think we want to try to participate in that when we find out when that is. So I know we typically have something here on one of the nights through the week before Thanksgiving, but we're looking at maybe trying to partner with the community and do something else with all the churches as a whole for Thanksgiving this year. So more on that. We'll let you know more about that when we find out. All right? All right, we have our usher show.
Thank you, Lord, for the beautiful day that you give us, Lord. Thank you for all the wonderful blessings that you give us, Lord. I ask that you please bless us and open our ears, Mr. Mark's message today, Lord, that we may take it out to the world and give to other people, Lord. Thank you for all you, so in Jesus' name, pray. Amen. Amen.
Yeah. guy but nobody. Wonder if I'll ever amount to love. Seems like no matter what I do, it's never gonna be good enough. Should I just give up? Lord, I need to hear you speak. Tell me I am loved. Tell me I am known. That you died for me. I am not alone. Tell me I'm your child. The one your heart beats for.
Known by mercy. Service, God, draw us closer to you. Empower us, Lord, to serve you better in Christ's name. Amen.
We're going to do one more. Mark talks about Christmas and Jesus coming and the fact that, we're about to celebrate the birth of our Savior. And he said, that's important, but let's not forget about the fact that that's our Savior and he died for our sins. And got me thinking about this song. We're going to sing Crucify for Christ. If you have a need, obviously if you need Jesus and you need a Savior, the altar's open and this will be a perfect time to do it. But if you have another need, you have something that's heavy on your heart, the Savior that died on the cross for you, and what this song talks about, he's available to lift you up, to give you strength through hard times.
Yes.
That's just one of the great things you get when you accept Jesus as your Savior. going to be right there on your end.
That's right.
It's very powerful. And this is a great song. You can sing along with us. But please feel free to move if you feel it during the song.
As I look back at what I thought was living, I'm amazed at the price I chose to pay. And to think I ignored what really mattered, 'cause I thought the sacrifice would be too great. When I finally reached the point of giving in, found the cross was calling even then. Even though it's a nightmare tonight, I never felt so much alive. Thank you.
a minute to just thank God. He's done so much for me in my life. For me to serve Him is nothing. Sometimes we think it's just super hard, and it is hard. But that's the least that I can do for all that He's done for me. He has protected me in ways that I don't even know that I was being protected. He has scooped us away from danger in times that we don't even know that He's scooped us away. He's provided strength in ways, in times that we couldn't even stand up and carry ourselves, but He's walked us through it. Man, I tell you what, He's done so much for us. Y'all, we should all be so blessed this morning and so thankful. There shouldn't have been anybody seated this morning. We should have just been praising Him. I've heard the term that God showed up and He showed out. Well, He shows up every Sunday. We just don't do anything. Amen? We need to thank Him. We need to praise Him. He's done so much for us in our lives. He's taken care of us. Listen, in the last 5 years of my life and different things that's going on in my life, He has carried me, and I've literally walked up from my job to go to the restroom or whatever, and every step I'd say, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for helping me. For getting me through this next minute. For getting me through this next hour. For getting me through this next thing. And I know when I look back at all of those times, it's Him that carried me. He's the one that got me through it, and He's continuing to get me through things. Now, I tell you what, I trust God. But I'm trusting Him for other things too, because there's some things that I've been praying for and been praying about that I know that He's going to give me an answer. That's and that right. I know that He's going to work things out for His glory and for His good, because He said He would.
That's right.
And I just want to praise Him. He's so good to us. He takes care of us. He is with us, and He is showing us, and He's directing us. Oh my goodness, I look over my family and I think, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, all the things that You've done, the good and the bad, because you know what? Even though the things we think that are bad, He does those things for His good and for His glory, and He's going to work it all together. And I just praise Him. Just praise Him for provision this morning. Praise Him for a good church this morning, for good friends, for a godly marriage, a godly home. So I just want to praise Him. I just didn't want to go sit down until I said that this morning. I just want to praise Him. Thank you.
Anybody else got a word of praise real quick? Okay. We're going to talk about the election this morning. Just for a minute. You know, when you're a pastor and you get up to preach, you can rant if you want to. And I'm going to read my rant, because I wrote this down yesterday. I don't want to leave anything out. So here's how it works. God didn't want us to have a king. You know that? Back when the nation of Israel looked at everybody else, they said, we want to be like everybody else, and we want to have a king. And so God allowed them to have a king, but with that king came a lot of trouble.
Amen.
You know, and but God allowed, He lets us make our own choices, doesn't He? So God allowed the nation of Israel to have a king, and that started things going in the wrong direction for us. And you know, because we didn't want a king anymore, we decided that was bad. We decided instead of a king, we're just going to govern ourselves. So we came over from England, and we came here. We started a new country called the United States. And wasn't called that immediately, but, you know, eventually became the United States. And so we decided we want to govern ourselves, because we'll be better at it than that one guy, the king. And we decided that what we needed was a representative form of government. We don't live in a democracy. We live in a representative republic, is how it actually is, right? Because we elect representatives to go, and on our behalf, they vote for this or vote against that, and so on. And they do whatever we wish, right? Because they're servants and that sort of thing. And, you know, we used to have term limits. And so I told you I was going to talk about politics. I don't talk about politics much. We used to have term limits. You know what they were? It used to be that the people that volunteered to be servants our country, they had regular jobs, and they said, I can only be gone for a little while, and I'm going to go back to the farm, or I'm going to go back to my business, because I've got other things to take care of. And the idea of a career politician didn't exist. And so we had term limits back then, but now it's we have these politicians, God bless them, that are quitting these high-paying jobs, these amazing careers that they've had, where they're just making all sorts of money and being a great success, and they've decided they want to go into politics and make less money than they're making, yet when they come out of office, it appears that they've gained quite a bit. And there's something a little fishy about that. I'm just saying it because it's true.
Exactly.
It's a little fishy to me. And so we have these politicians that are elected officials, and it's like, you already heard the saying, it's like the pot calling the kettle black. We have Democrats and Republicans and independents and other, you know, when you go to vote and you fill out the other blank all the time, you know, you don't want to be with those other guys. We have all these groups, and it's like a bunch of pots and a bunch of kettles. They're all about the same, and, you know, the pot calling the kettle black and that sort of thing. And so it's really the same. It's not based on this party or that party. And if you're a Democrat or you're a Republican or an independent or whatever, you know, that really doesn't matter to me. Because God never intended for us to govern ourselves. He intended to be God in our lives. So now this group of pots and kettles, they can't even count votes.
That's right.
And so if you can't count a vote, what are you doing in office?
Amen.
So if we can't count and we can't govern ourselves, and we don't want a king, we don't want a dictator or ruler, who's left? And it's God.
Right.
What we've done in this country is we've trusted career politicians. We have trusted them, and they have broken that trust. I'm not talking about starting a revolution. Y'all getting ready. Y'all going to go to your car and get the gun, aren't you? Hey, let's go. And no, just kidding. So we have trusted this country and trusted our future to people that don't know what we want and don't care what we want.
Right.
Because it's about them, isn't it? Mm-hmm. And I would venture to say that most, if not all of them, have gotten caught up in this idea of self, and we've been studying that in Sunday school, is what made me think of all this. They're caught up in this idea of, I'm going to get mine, I don't care if you get yours or not. And so they have chosen a path that makes them richer, more powerful, more prestigious, and so on. And we have to take what's left over. We've trusted politicians, and look where it's gotten us. The country's in a mess, isn't it?
Exactly.
And it's all because the nation of Israel wanted a king. There's one king. You know, although this is what we've chosen as a nation, I'm just going to say it anyway. I don't trust any of them any further than I can throw them.
Amen.
I'm going to put my trust in God. I think it's time to choose God. Amen. You know what we ought to do is run a campaign to re-elect God. Amen. We ought to re-elect him and put him back in office and just acknowledge him as the supreme leader in our lives. And we hear the Carol was talking about in Sunday school about polls that were taken, and everybody says, oh yeah, I believe in God, I'm a Christian, and so on and so forth, but you don't see it in their life. And so the proof is in the pudding, and I've always said that wrong. That's not how it goes. It's the proof in the pudding is in the tasting. So when we experience what others, that's the actual saying. I looked it up. So what that means is, you know, it's not just that it's pudding, it's what does it taste like?
Right.
You know, you can look at the expiration date on a pudding cup. Be careful. I just know that by experience. They don't always tell you the truth. So, what does this have to do with church? I just wanted to have this little rant about where we are as a nation and who we've trusted to point us in the right direction of trusting God. And we're going to talk about faith this morning. And having faith in God. I don't know who you have faith in. You may have faith in your doctor or your attorney or, you know, some sort of other professional person you work with, and that's great. Good luck with that because they're human. And you know, but where's your trust with God? What is that like? Now, I'm going to ask the question today. What kind of faith? You have faith in God? I got faith in God. Well, what kind of faith? We're going to look at 1 Kings chapter 17. We're going to talk about faith. And it really did have something to do with the election. We got our faith in the wrong things, don't we? So, 1 Kings chapter 17. Anybody got your faith in the stock market? Lower your hand. Yes. 1 Kings 17. I'm going to read the whole chapter. I don't ever do that. I'm going to do it today. So listen fast. 1 Kings chapter 17. Now, Elijah was a prophet of God, and he had just, what happened in chapter 16 is important, because the nation of, Jerusalem was ruled by Ahab, who was a wicked king, a wicked ruler, and he had gotten himself all involved in idolatry. Anybody heard the name Jezebel? Wasn't Jezebel his wife? Mm-hmm. Okay, boy, I'm glad I got that part right. So she was into idolatry, and he went into idolatry with her. And the Bible says that God was, I'm just going to phrase it this way, Brother Wayne, God was madder at him than he'd ever been at anybody else. Any other ruler of the day, he was more mad at Ahab than anybody. And so he told Elijah, he said, Elijah, I want you to declare a drought. Don't tell him I said so. And that's where we are in this chapter. And Elijah the Tishbite of the inhabitants of Gilead said to Ahab, he's going to give him the message, as the Lord God of Israel lives, before whom I stand, there shall not be dew nor rain these years except by my word. He was proclaiming a drought in the land. And it wasn't by the word of Elijah, it was by the word of the Lord. Through Elijah. Elijah was just delivering the message. In verse 2, then the word of the Lord came to Elijah, saying, get away from here. And that's because Ahab was really upset with him. Get away from here and turn eastward and hide by the brook Cherith, which flows into the Jordan. And it will be that you shall drink from the brook, and I have commanded the ravens to feed you there. Interesting story. So he went and he did according to the word of the Lord, for he went and stayed by the brook Cherith, which flows from the Jordan. And the ravens brought him bread and meat in the morning and bread and meat in the evening. And he drank from the brook. And it happened after a while that the brook dried up because there had been no rain in the land. Then the word of the Lord came to him saying, arise and go to Zarephath, which belonged to Sidon, and dwell there. See, I've commanded a widow there to care for you, to provide for you. So he rose and he went to Zarephath, and when he had come to the gate of the city, indeed a widow was there gathering sticks. And he called to her and said, please bring me a little cup of water in a cup that I may drink. And as she was going to get it, he called to her and said, please bring me a morsel of bread in your hand. And so she said, as the Lord your God lives, I don't have bread. I've only got a handful of flour in a bin and a little oil in a jar. And see, I'm gathering a couple of sticks that I may go in and prepare it for myself and my son, that we may eat it and die. You see, there was a drought. They were running out of food. In fact, they had run out of food except for this one more meal. And this was the situation they were in. In verse 13, Elijah said to her, do not fear. Go and do as you have said. Go and prepare the meal, but make me a small cake from it first and bring it to me. Then afterward, make some for yourself and your son. For thus says the Lord God of Israel, the bin of flour shall not be used up, nor shall the jar of oil run dry until the day the Lord sends rain on the earth. So she went away and did according to the word of Elijah. And she and her household ate for many days. The bin of flour was not used up, nor did the jar of oil run dry, according to the word of the Lord which he spoke by Elijah. Now just a few more verses here. Now it happened after these things that the son of the woman who owned the house became sick. And his sickness was so serious that there was no breath left in him. So she said to Elijah, what have I to do with you, O man of God? Have you come to me to bring my sin to remembrance and to kill my son? And he said to her, give me your son. So he took him out of her arms and carried him to the upper room where he was staying and laid him on his own bed. Then he cried out to the Lord and said, oh, Lord my God, have you also brought tragedy on the widow with whom I lodged by killing her son? And he stretched himself out on the child three times, and he cried out to the Lord, and he said, O Lord my God, I pray, let this child's soul come back to him. Then the Lord heard the voice of Elijah, and the soul of the child came back to him, and he revived. Verse 23, and Elijah took the child, and he brought him down from the upper room into the house, and gave him to his mother, and Elijah said, see, your son lives. Then the woman said to Elijah, now by this I know that you are a man of God and that the word of the Lord in your mouth is the truth. Let's pray. Father, we thank you, Lord, for the truth. And Lord, our prayer in this nation and in this world is that somehow the truth will win out. The truth will be told and understood. And Father, you would become God again in this nation, in this world. God, we know that's your plan eventually to do that, but Lord, we pray for our country right now. We pray for our churches. We pray for ourselves as individuals that we would listen to your voice. We'd answer the question in our own minds and hearts today, what kind of faith do we really have? What kind of faith? Lord, I pray that you bless each one that's here, Lord, whatever need there is, whatever needs to be changed. God, I pray that that would begin today. That need would be met. That situation would be taken care of. Lord, that we just have faith in you. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. All right. So it's a great chapter. I don't like to read the scriptures so much because it takes some time, you know, but that's just a great story, isn't it? You can't help but read that. It's an amazing story. So the question is, what kind of faith? And we'll look first at what kind of faith Elijah had. First, he had an obedient faith. You remember when God told him to go speak to Ahab? That was the kind of faith. He had to have faith to do that. Lord, this man could kill me. He's probably got soldiers all around him. I'm going to go talk to him and give him bad news about a drought. Are you kidding? He had to have faith to do that. Amen? He had to have faith when God said, hey, you need to get out of here. No kidding, God. I had that same feeling. I agree with you. Go down by the brook and I'm going to take care of you. I'm going to send birds to feed you. That took faith. What if God gave you a message in the morning? You're waking up and you're kind of in that half awake and half asleep state of mind. And suddenly you hear the voice of God. He says, look, I don't want you to go to work today. I'm just going to send you a check in the mail. I don't want you to get up and lift a finger to do anything because I'm going to take care of you. I'm going to send birds. Or maybe for you in your neighborhood, there's not so much the bird. Maybe it's the squirrels. We've got a lot of squirrels back behind the house. And they're going to bring you stuff to eat. And you can drink water out of the creek in the back of, you know. Yeah. Wouldn't that be great? Would you have enough faith to say, okay, God. So Elijah had great faith, didn't he? It was a faith that made him act. It was a faith that made him go to Ahab. It was the kind of faith that made him go to the brook, like God had said. And so God was sustaining him. It's faith that took action. James chapter 2, verse 18. The writer of the book of James is the brother of Jesus, I believe. And James says this. He said, show me your faith without your works, and I'll show you my faith by my works. So faith is not faith at all unless there's action attached to it. Right? That's what James was saying. I believe what James said. So here it is now, the story goes on, and the brook has dried up. Now think about it. This is the brook that God created to sustain Elijah. After Elijah told Ahab the bad news, he ran away, he hid near that brook, and he was going to drink water from the brook, and the ravens were going to bring him food, and everything was good, and suddenly the brook dried up. God also dried up the brook because he told him, there's going to be a drought. I want you to proclaim a drought. And he's, so God, I figured that brook would be kind of exempt from the drought. He said, no, that's not how it works. I could proclaim drought. There's going to be a drought. And so I wonder what do you suppose Elijah was thinking? You know, God made the brook. God sent the drought. God dried up the brook. God, what's the plan here? Right? Elijah, maybe he was thinking, you know, you sent me here to provide for me. And you know, you're telling me now I need to go and see a widow in Zarephath. I need to go somewhere else. And if I leave, those ravens aren't going to know where to bring the food. And sometimes we try to rationalize the things that God is telling us to do. And we think, hey, it doesn't make sense in my mind, so it couldn't be right. Well, guess what? God knows more than I do, and he knows more than you do. And he does have a plan. Elijah had the kind of faith that was obedient. He had an obedient faith, a faith that called him to take action. He went down to Zarephath just like God told him, even though it didn't make sense. You know, Elijah and like us, we can forget. If we're not careful, we forget that God can do all things. And however he wants to do it is always the best plan, isn't it? You know, the kind of faith you have can be measured by your level of obedience to God. Because obedience doesn't come first and then faith. It's faith first. And obedience is the product of faith, right? So obedience is an action because of your faith. So he made him leave the brook and go to Zarephath. So Elijah had an obedient sort of faith. And then also he had a tested faith. Now I'm going to tell you, the kind of faith that's tested is the kind of faith you want to have. Faith that has not been tested, you can't even declare that to be faith. You don't even know if it is or not, right? It's like, so we've got this swing on our back porch, and I bought these hangers that are supposed to carry, it's 250 pounds a piece or 500 pounds a piece, you know, the really heavy cast aluminum little hangers from China. And they got to be good. And I'm wondering, every time I get in the swing, I wonder how good these really are. You know, and we have people over the house, and you get three or four kids in the swing, they're going back and forth. I wonder how these really good. Well, they've kind of been tested, you know, but I wonder, are they really as strong as what it says? And so, is our faith really as strong as what we may think it is? And unless our faith is tested, we don't know if that faith is great. A tested faith continues, it survives. A test. It survives a trial. This tested faith gets stronger, right? And so God sent Elijah to Zarephath. And what do you suppose he was thinking when he met the widow? So here's my take on it. I think how many preppers do we have out here? You don't want to raise your hand because you don't want to be identified, right? I get it. Because you don't want anybody to know that you're a prepper, because when it gets really bad, they'll go and try to get your stuff. I get it. That's not how it is. I think Elijah thought the widow was a prepper, but knew what she turned out to be, a pauper. He thought she might have a lot. God sent me to this widow, so she's going to have a lot. She's going to have plenty to take care of me. But listen to what the Bible says. It says that she was getting, and I'm getting way ahead of myself, and I didn't want to do this, but I'm doing it anyway. Did you hear what she said? Can you go to that scripture? I can go back to mine. I'm just going to read the scripture. He goes there, he sees the widow, and he asks her for a cup of water. He said, oh, by the way, as you're getting the water, bring me something to eat, if you don't mind. Thanks. And here's what she says. Verse 12. I don't have anything to give you to eat. I don't have bread. He said, bring me some bread. I don't have bread. All I have is a handful of flour. How much bread would a handful of flour make? Not much. And I've got a few drops of oil in a jar. And I've got just enough to make something for my son and myself. And then we're going to eat that, and it's going to be our last meal, and we're just expecting to die. This wasn't the kind of woman that Elijah wanted to find. He wanted to find someone that was a widow and maybe had been left a small fortune and would have plenty of food and water and that kind of thing. I'm sure he was looking at the widow saying, Lord, are you sure this is the right widow? Maybe is there any other widows here? Because we question God, don't we? Are you sure this is what you want me to do, God? Elijah was a man of faith. Really interesting what the woman said. I don't have any bread. All I've got is a little flour and a little oil. And you know, do you hear the most amazing thing she said? The craziest thing she said? I'm gathering a couple of sticks to make a fire to cook. How much can you cook on a couple of sticks? That's where the woman was. She was in a desperate place. And God sent Elijah, his own prophet, to the woman who's already in a desperate place. So it's interesting. Elijah still asked her. He saw what she was doing. He heard the answer. Listen to what he says. And, you know, gosh, I keep saying I'm getting ahead of myself. Let's not get ahead of myself. This tested faith. Elijah had a tested faith. Going to Zarephath was a test. Lord, you sent me here. You said you're going to take care of it. Now that the brook's dried up, he said, go to Zarephath. I'll take care of it there. Go find a widow. She's going to care for you. She's going to take care of you. She's going to provide for you. And he goes and he finds a widow that doesn't have anything to take care of him with. These are all tests of faith. You know, God, do you really have a plan? Have you checked on that plan lately? Maybe you need to tweak a few things because it's not looking like it's going to work out. And that's what we do to God. Especially in the middle of a test. And we see things that don't make sense. We say, God, is this really what you want? We ask those questions. And we forget that God tests our faith. A test of faith happens when your opinion and God's opinion are not the same. When your direction and God's direction are not the same. When your understanding and God's understanding are not the same. And we run upon those every day, don't we? You know, everybody's faith is tested. Untested faith really isn't faith at all. And listen to this. I wrote this down. This is cool. Faith constantly tested will remain constant through every test, right? There's constant testing of your faith because God wants your faith to be constantly growing, right? He wants your faith to be stronger, maturing. You've heard the old saying, what doesn't kill you makes you stronger. Yeah, I don't know who said that, but I know where they copied it from. They copied it from the book of James. Look at what the book of James says. James 1, verses 2 through 4. Count it all joy when you fall into various trials or tests, knowing that the trying of your faith works patience, but let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. God's desire for us is to have faith, then to have that faith tested, for that faith to grow stronger, and then the next test, it grows stronger, and it continues to grow stronger, and it produces the fruit of the Spirit in our life, and finally we make it to maturity, and we have a mature faith. So Elijah had an obedient faith, and he had a tested faith. Let's talk about a maturing faith. I believe Elijah's faith was growing and strengthening every day. And I just have to ask you, do you sense a test in your life right now? Do you got a test going on in your life right now? Anybody just like me and Jeff and Sylvia? We have tests. Y'all pray for us.
Yes, please.
And I'm going to pray for y'all because y'all don't even have the strength to lift your hand. So there's testing going on in our life right now. The real question is not, is your faith being tested? Because it is. But how are you doing on the test? What's your grade going to be on the test? You know? Is that, are you going to pass the test or are you going to mature before the test? That's the real question, isn't it? Are you maturing in your faith? You know, nobody would say that my faith is not being tested, it's not under attack. You know, I never have any opposition. That's just, I need to speak to you if that's the case. I need to find out what you're doing. I need to do that. If you're being tested and your faith isn't growing and God's not accomplishing His work in your life, you need to ask God, God, what do I need to do? Lord, I want to be closer to you and I want to be stronger. I want my faith to grow, Lord. I'll endure the testing. I won't turn away from it. I'll go through it. Just go through it with me, Lord. I want to be stronger. And that's what we should be saying. So, he had a maturing sort of faith. You know, all the things that Elijah had already been through, they just strengthened his faith. And now, you'll see it when he speaks to the woman. You'll see his faith. And see, I want to get to this last thing. You know, you've got obedient faith, and you've got tested faith, and you've got maturing faith. And then the last one is an amazing component of faith that doesn't happen until you get close to maturity or until it matures enough that you can manifest this kind of component of faith. It's the faith that is shared. A shared faith. Listen to what Elijah said to the woman. I'm going to go back. See? Go back to the scripture. Look at verse 13. He said, do not fear. She'd already told him, I don't have any bread to give you. I've just got a little flour and a little oil and a couple of sticks. That's all it's going to take to cook it. We're going to cook that. Me and my son are going to eat it, and then we're just going to die because that's it. We're done. You know, that's the popular saying, right? We're done. And then those people just keep talking about being done, and they're not really done, right? That's why I don't like the fans. So listen to what he said. She'd already explained the gravity of the situation. Listen to what Elijah said. Elijah said to her, verse 13, do not fear. Go and do as you have said. Go ahead and prepare, just like you were going to, you know, Finish up your plan, your two sticks, your little oil, your handful of flour. Make some food. Do not fear. Go and do as you said. Look at the next thing you said. But make me a small cake from it first. We were just talking about selfishness and narcissism in Sunday school. You know, being self-centered and me first. That Elijah, man. Don't think of it like that. This was a test of faith, wasn't it? Not faith in Elijah, but faith in the God that Elijah served. So Elijah says, you make it to me first. I want you to put God first. I want you to have faith in God. I want you to do something that will show me your faith. And God, and Elijah's doing this on behalf of God. This is not something that Elijah just gets a kick out of to do. It's, let me see if she'll make me one first, because I'm really hungry. It wasn't about that. It was about putting God first and trusting God. Even with that last meal, a couple of sticks and a little drop of oil and a handful of flour. He was asking her to trust God with that, with all that she had. Interesting thing for him to say. Do not fear. Go and do as you said. Go prepare the food. Make it for me first and bring it to me. He said, and then afterward, make some for yourself and your son. What's the afterward look like? When all you've got is two sticks and a little bit of oil and a handful of flour, and it's one enough for, I guess, for two people. Yes, Elijah was really hungry, right? What's it going to look like when you use all that stuff? There's not going to be any afterward. But he's saying to this woman, there's going to be an afterward. And listen to what he says after that. Verse 14. For thus says the Lord God of Israel, the bin of flour shall not be used up, nor shall the jar of oil run dry until the day the Lord sends rain on the earth. Elijah is giving her a promise and testing her. Did you have enough faith to believe the promise of God and go and make me some food first and then go back to that empty jar and that empty bin of flour and make something for yourself? He might as well have said, you know what, before you get going, gather up some more sticks because you're going to have to be cooking some more. You know, that would have been an act of faith, wouldn't it, Pat? Wouldn't that have been great? The woman turns around, she's going to go back and make it. She starts picking up more wood. What are you doing? Well, you said I was going to have plenty of flowers. I'm going to just take more. I'm going to make a big meal. That'd be faith, wouldn't it? We seldom do those sorts of things, but we need to be doing those sorts of things. We need to proclaim our faith in God. This woman, I'm sure she was afraid and she was reluctant. But she's in a desperate situation, and I think sometimes God puts us in situations that are desperate so that we will turn to Him, and then He tests our faith. After we have a little faith, He tests our faith, and it grows, and then He wants us to share that faith. And that's where Elijah was in his life. He was at the place where his faith had matured enough where he could begin to share it with others. He said, do not fear. Go and do as you said. Make me something first. And then he gave him the promise that God said, the flour's not going to be used up. The oil's not going to be used up until the drought is over. And the woman chose faith. Verse 15 says that she went away and did according to the word of Elijah. Actually, the woman went away and did according to the word of the Lord that Elijah had shared with her. This was an act of faith performed by this woman. So, this faith that's shared is a faith that blesses others. Are you blessing others with your faith? God sent Elijah to the widow so that Elijah could be sustained. But God also sent Elijah to the widow so the widow could be sustained. And both of them were going to be in a test of faith. What do they call it? Gosh, a crisis of faith. Right? I'm either going to believe or I'm not. It's going to turn me this way or that way. It's a life-changing point. The woman believed and she acted in faith. Elijah shared what she needed to hear. He shared his faith in God. Gave her that promise from God. So, what kind of faith did the woman really have? Talked about Elijah having, what kind of faith did Elijah have?
Obedient.
Obedient faith?
Tested faith.
Tested faith? A growing faith? Somebody wrote them down? Great. And the last one was a shared faith. What kind of faith did the woman have? We don't know what her background was, but we know that she'd already suffered the loss of her husband. Like everybody in the town, she was being affected by the drought. She'd come to the end of what she had. She'd come to the end of what she could do. She found herself in a desperate situation, right? And so you can understand where the woman was by her words. And I just want to say this. Do we really listen to people when they speak to us, when we have a conversation? Are we really listening to the words that they say? Because their words tell us what's in their heart. Mm-hmm. Right? Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks, the Bible says. So the woman said this, I don't have any bread, just a little flour, just a little oil, just enough that a couple of sticks will cook it. We're going to die. That's where the woman was. And I think about that, and I think about the promise of God. What do you think happened when the woman went back after giving Elijah the food? What was the woman thinking as she's walking back? Well, I sure hope this works. I don't know why I did that. I guess I didn't have anything to lose anyway. Or maybe she was thinking, boy, I sure hope what he said is true. If what he said is true, then we're going to make it. Maybe she started having a little hope, and as she took a step, maybe that flour bin started filling up, you know? And as she took another step, the oil started pouring into the cruse, you know, into the bottle, and it was just getting more and more. And can you imagine her going back into the kitchen and seeing a full bin of flour and a full glass? Well, wouldn't that have been great? Or maybe she saw just enough to fix enough food to sustain them for a day. And then that night she went to bed, then she got up and she turned the light on. I know it was a candle she was burning, but she turned the light on and it was empty. The jar of oil was empty and the flour bin was empty. God, I'm just going to have faith in you. And she got up that morning and it was just enough for that day. Kind of like manna was, right? Faith that is mature is a faith that's practiced day by day. A faith that is obedient day by day. A faith that's tested day by day is one that grows more mature day by day. That's the kind of faith that God wants us to have. You know what? If it was like this, and God said, you know what? Now that you're saved, so I appreciate you accepting Jesus, and you get an email that says, welcome to the kingdom of God. Everything you need is right here. Just scan this code. You know how things are these days. And if it was like that, and you had food delivered, you never had to even leave your house, didn't have to cook the food, and God's just going to give you everything. You never have to do anything for yourself. And wouldn't it be great if everything was like that? Well, you know, maybe that's what heaven is going to be like. I don't know, but that's not what life is like. God expects us to have faith, even when it doesn't look like we should have faith. God expects us to have faith in Him. So I'm going to ask you, you know, we talk about what kind of faith the widow had and what kind of faith Elijah had. What kind of faith do you have right now? Maybe you're where Elijah is. I hope you are. I hope you're at that level of mature faith where you're constantly sharing your faith with somebody else, and somebody comes and you hear the desperation in their words, so you know their heart is in a desperate place, and you say, look, I know the Lord, and He's brought me through so many things, and I can tell you so many stories, but listen, He said He's going to take care of us, and if you'll give yourself to Him, He's going to take care of you too. Are you sharing your faith? Are you building other people up through your mature faith? Through this shareable faith, right? Maybe you're like Elijah. That's what he was doing. Maybe you're right where the widow was. You're in a desperate situation. You've come to the end of all that you have and the end of all that you can do. You don't know what else to do, and you're in a desperate spot, and you need to have some hope. You need to have some reason to believe tomorrow's going to be better. You need to have faith in God this morning. If you're saved this morning, Jesus said, I'm going to send another comforter to you. He's going to be the Spirit of truth. He's going to live inside of you. He's going to empower you, and He's going to direct you. He's going to teach you, and He's going to remind you of all the things I said so that you'll never be without me. This presence of the Holy Spirit in us gives us strength to walk through those times that look dark. You might be like that widow and walking through a dark place today. He said He'd never leave you nor forsake you. You need to have faith. Stir up that faith that's in you. You need to have faith in God. Or you may be where a lot of people in this country are. You may be in a place where you live a life where you've got plenty of everything. You're enjoying every moment of life. And you're doing all that you can do to entertain yourself and your family, and you're completely unaware that you're poor and blind and wretched and naked and that you need God. When God was giving out the sending the letters and the messages to the seven churches of Asia, that was one of them. It was one of the churches that thought, hey, we got it made, we're all set. And they didn't realize how far away from God they were. You may be in that spot this morning. You need to start living by faith. You need to have that obedient faith. Is God asking you to do things? And are you being obedient to Him? Is your faith being tested and you're walking away from the test rather than going through it so that you can be stronger? Are you seeking to be tested by God so that you can become stronger? Is your faith maturing? Are you sharing your faith with others? I'm going to tell you something that, and it's the last thing I'll say. God is in control. Can we go all the way back to verse 1? Okay. Let's go all the way back to verse 1. Verse 1, about halfway through it, it says, "As the Lord God of Israel lives, before whom I stand, there shall not be dew nor rain these years." And listen to this, these three words. "Except at my word." That's four. "Except at my word." This is God speaking through Elijah. If God can control the weather, because He caused the drought, if God can send him to the brook that, maybe that was the brook that was going to dry up last, and that's why He sent Elijah there. If He can command birds to feed Elijah twice a day, He can surely be seen as the God who's in control of all things. So the good news is that God is in control. The issue is this. Sometimes we believe that God has lost control because of what's going on in the world. And sometimes we believe that God has lost control because of the situations in our lives. And sometimes we think that God has lost control of things because He's allowing others to do things that negatively affect us. And he's the wicked are prospering and all that sort of thing. And we're saying, God, what's going on? And we don't think that God is in control anymore. God has not lost control. We were talking about it in Sunday school a couple of weeks ago. How the enemy is the ruler of this world right now. We can see it in the world and how he's distracting people and he's causing people to believe things that are not true. And, you know, he's taking away discernment from us. We can't even tell what truth is. And we live in this world that's all mixed up. That doesn't mean that God is not in control. I'm going to have faith in God this morning that He's in full control. And He wants to be in control of us, doesn't He? He's in control of everything. We need to give Him control of us. And will you do that this morning? I guess is the question. What kind of faith do you have in God? Do you have faith that He's worthy for us to give Him control of our life? Do you have faith that God can take care of all the situations in your life? Do you have that kind of faith? What kind of faith do you have? Is it a living faith that's proven by your works? Is it faith that's tested? Is it strong? What kind of faith do you have? Would you stand with me? We're going to pray right now and just ask God to lead us in this time of invitation. God, we come to you now in the name of your Son, Jesus. And Lord, we know that God, as jumbled as our thoughts can be, it all comes down to faith, doesn't it, Lord? We have faith that you're listening to our prayer right now because you said so. We have faith that Jesus died on the cross. We've experienced salvation and we have felt the presence of the Holy Spirit in our hearts and our lives, God. And we've seen you work and do amazing things. And so, God, our faith is growing. But God, sometimes our faith gets weak. And when our faith is weak and we see the situations in the world and how deceived the world is, God, we begin to even lose hope sometimes. God, I pray this morning would be the day that we proclaim you as our King, as the one who's supremely in control. And Lord, the day that we will give ourselves over to your complete control. God, your plan is better than ours. It always has been, Father. And regardless of whether we understand it, God, help us to walk in faith, to walk in obedience, to know that you're with us through every test, to know that you desire for us to grow in faith. Lord, and that, Lord, we'll get to that place where we can share our faith with others. Lord, help us to be useful to you in the building of your kingdom. Help us to come back to you. Proclaim our faith in you once again, Lord, as a church, as individuals. Lord, I pray for this country that all the faith that we might have and the things that man can do, God, I pray that that faith would go by the wayside. Father, we turn again to you. Lord, I pray that you make it so. Father, we just praise you and we thank you for what you're going to do. If there's somebody here who has a need, I pray that they would have faith to come and pray. Lord, if there's somebody here who's lost, I pray they would have faith in your Son Jesus and in the promise that he'll forgive sin and give eternal life. I pray that they would have faith in you. Father, I pray that you just have your way in this time of invitation, God. We pray it in the name of Jesus. Amen.
You come and pray if you need to.
Everybody falls sometimes. Gotta find the strength to rise from the ashes and make a new beginning. Anyone can feel the ache. You think it's more than you can take, but you're stronger, stronger than you know. Give up now, sun will soon be shining. Gotta face the clouds, find the silver lining. I've seen dreams that move the mountains, hope that doesn't ever end, even when the sky is falling.
Let's bow our heads together right now. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus. And Lord, as we bow together today, Lord, we want to bring our request to you. Father, I pray that you give us enough faith to raise our hand and say, I need God's help. Give us that faith, Lord, to act, to just raise our hand. God, I need your help today. Father, you saw the hands that went up. You know the needs of our lives. God, we're admitting to you that we need help. We can't change ourselves, but Lord, through your power, you can change us into the people you want us to be. God, I pray that you'd accomplish that today. Father, we give you control of our lives. Lord, we raise our hands once again. We say, God, we want to give you control. Give that up to you right now, Father. Choose to believe you. Father, help us to trust in you, to have the faith in your word, to have the faith that's obedient, the faith that stands the test, the faith that's mature, and the faith that's growing. Lord, especially the faith that we can share with others. God, I pray that you bless us, Lord. Make us into the people you want us to be. Anybody have a word for the Lord this week? Word of praise. God done anything good for you this week?
Brother Mark, he's given me into racial faith. For the last 5 years, he's gave us faith and strength.
Amen.
And I don't know where we'd be this morning if the Lord didn't supply us with that.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Amen. Who else? We have quiet faith this morning.
I think the lady in the scripture that you mentioned, she had faith of knowledge of God. That got her through that. That's the reason she made that cake for Elijah.
Yeah.
So that's the kind of faith we need also.
We did. We sure did.
To get us through every day.
It's interesting. Think about when it said, according to his word.
Right.
And, man, are you in your Bible all the time and being aware, keeping yourself aware of God's word? That seems like a little thing. We've been told since grade school, you know. Was it PB&J? Prayer, Bible study, and Jesus, you know. Yeah. But it's true.
Right.
You need to be aware of God's word. Keep it in the forefront all the time. Amen. Who else, real quick? Appreciate everybody being here. We got Thanksgiving service coming up next Sunday morning. Looking forward to that. There's going to be snacks afterwards. Actually, there's going to be a really big dinner afterwards. And it's going to be substantial. Yes, absolutely. And we're going to enjoy that time of fellowship together. So the rest of this week, be thinking about how thankful you are to God. And use those times that you remember, those times that you can be thankful for. Use those times to build your faith up. You know, sometimes I'll tell you what happened to me. So I got all these, I love journals. I really do. I love any kind of journal. I see them in the store. I want to buy one. I've got a bunch of them. I don't need another one. I just want to buy. I just like them. And a nice pen, right? And all that. And now I'm kind of writing on an electronic journal and a different kind of pen and all this stuff. But I just like it. And I go back and we moved some books from downstairs to upstairs, two different closets, and moved some books upstairs. And I found a bunch of those old journals. And I'd go like the first 20 or 30 pages would be filled with stuff I wrote in the journal, and then the rest of it's blank, and I started a different one, you know. And I started a different one over here. Man, if I could ever put those together, it might be something that I would see. You know, God's doing something in your life, but you know, there's been those interruptions in the times that I've really sat down and just written down my thoughts about God and all that kind of thing. And I think sometimes we get distracted, don't we? And sometimes we lose our journals and we forget what God has done. And I write down things in them and they're really important things. And wow, I forgot about that. We need to look back and remember all that God has done for us and use those as blocks to build that wall of faith that goes around us and protects us and keeps us focused. And we need to be, build our faith by what God has already done. And you know what? We got this great book called the Bible. Tells us what he's going to do. I love that. We know that what God is going to do, that he's not just in control today, but he's in control of tomorrow. And we don't have to worry about tomorrow because he's already taken care of it. I just want to encourage you to go this week and be thankful. Think about things every day that God has done for you and let that build up your faith and then share it with somebody else. Amen. Anybody else? We're going to quit. We're going to pray. Again, appreciate everybody being here. Brother Jerry, why don't you dismiss us?
Father, we want to come to you right now, Father, thanking you for this service and for your presence and the Spirit that's with us today, Father. Thank you for your holy word, Father, for bringing it to us this morning in the way that you have. So we can take it into the world, Father, and Father, not only have all these different forms of faith that we've had, but be able to share that faith with the world and bring those into your kingdom. Father, we just ask that you to lead us and bring us back again. These things, pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Amen.